plugin of the week is the Waves Abbey Road Vinyl. The Abbey Road Vinyl is a plugin that's now a new addition to the Abbey Road collection from Waves. This is a very, very, very unique plugin. Nobody has done anything remotely close to this, which I really love. Now, there are vinyl plugins which will give you some characteristics, or they'll let you select speeds and you get cricks and crackles and pops and stuff like that. But this is way, way, way more than that. It's much more in depth. What Waves has done here is they've actually gone back to Abbey Road and they've gone to the cutting rooms that they had there, and they've gone through the process of actually emulating the full cutting process, which includes running through TG desk, the original mastering desk that they would run all their audio through. They would actually go through emulation of the whole cutting of the lacquer and what the playback of the lacquer sounds like. Then actually emulations of how in the process of taking that lacquer and turning it into a final print, into a vinyl record, what that sounds like. And in addition to those types of things, they also give you the option to work with two different turntables, the Abbey Road turntable, which is basically the cutting lathe that they can play back what they've cut right on a turntable, right on the cutting lathe, or a DJ turntable. And then you get the selection of three different cartridges. And so we'll kind of go through some of those options right there. So you can turn that off and then you have the options right here. So this is really cool. You also have a couple of different noise sections. So you have an overall noise, crackle, density is the number of clicks. And then you have a volume control for the clicks and stuff like that. So you can get, determine like how much of any of this stuff that you want. You could see a little bit of it right there, and I could bring up right where you could take some of that. So that's some of the noise component. That's the crackling component. And then you could bring up the clicks. And then the more dense you make them, you start to get that. So you get three different, distinctly different components of what that is. And you could turn any or all of them off, which is kind of cool. You have input and output control, so you can kind of drive it through here. There's also actually a stage here with a metering where you could set your meters to the standard you have for your DAW. So it ranges all the way from 8 all the way up to minus 24. So you have a lot of options there, and the default is minus 18. You also have the ability to drive the audio signal passing into it, so you can sort of overdrive the whole mechanism. You have separate controls for the wow and the flutter, because every vinyl cut will have some variations that might equate to some variations of warping or inconsistency with the speed of the DAC, et cetera, all of those sorts of things. So those factors built in. And then you have a whole phase distortion section as well. So this allows you to also amp up, like, and you'll see this when we actually feed in the noise, the phase distortion that occurs when you're playing back the audio signal. So there's all these different distortion characteristics, and you can actually, I'll play that back, you'll be able to hear, and then I'll show you exactly what it's doing here. We have filters for the top and the low end for, you know, where that noise exists, or that distortion exists. And then there's also a very unique feature, which is something that allows you to make this sound like a record player, like the power cord got pulled and then it slows down to a stop, and you get that whole thing with the pitch diving and all of that. But it actually works actively with the music that's feeding into it. And you can work on a time bass, or you can work on a tempo bass, where you can fit in a specific number of bars and have it follow through there. So we'll kind of go through some of the demos, and I'll kind of show you how some of this stuff is just really interesting, really unique, and we'll kind of take it here. So essentially, if we kind of take it from here, I'm going to run some audio in, and then let's kind of go through some of the different characteristic things and how you add them in. So like, if we don't want to deal with the noise, this is stuff that's easily, you could just kind of pull them out and that element of it is gone. So let's take that out, and then we could focus on some of the different tonal characters that this adds in. So one thing you'll start off with, the lacquer. The lacquer is the most clean and accurate representation of the original audio signal that's being fed in, because it's the first cut. And when you go to the actual process of creating a vinyl record, you go through these plating processes where they take the lacquer, which is basically like a soft polyvinyl chloride, and then they chemically treat it And then they basically, what amounts to like an electroplating type of thing. And they take that electroplate, they extract it, and then they make another copy off of that. They make another copy off of that. And then you create what are called stampers. So it's a multi-stage process. And in every one of those different processes, what ends up happening is you lose a little bit of something along the way. The reason why they have to do this is that the original cut is actually like what you have. So when you make an impression of that, you only get one of them. And so that one impression then would create something that could be a record that you could play where the grooves are inward, not outward. But because that's the only one, that stamper would wear out more quickly. So what they do is they create a negative of that and then a positive of that, or multiple positives of that, that they used as what they would call stampers that they actually use. So when the polyvinyl chloride drops down, it's like a blob, like the size of a hockey puck, and then it gets squished with like 100 pounds of pressure with the A side and the B side, you know, top and bottom, and it just presses it. They carve away or cut away all the stuff that's on the outside, and then it's laid down to cool. And then you can actually play it back, and you could get like what they call like a test pressing to see what the sound. So they send that back to the mastering house, and they compare that up against, you know, what they have on the original master. So let's have a listen to what this sounds like, and I'll just kind of switch through some of the different components just to give you an idea. So we'll start with the Abbey Road turntable and the MM cartridge. The MM cartridge is a moving magnet cartridge from the 1980s. I'm thinking this is probably a Shure cartridge, maybe a V15. This is not documented, just what little I know. I'm not a DJ, and I didn't go, you know, through that in, you know, in real depth, but I think that's probably what this is. So let's see. A much more open sound if I take the TG desk out. I can also hit this less hard. You know, drive this up here and balance the input and output level. Now let's show you here the difference between the lacquer and the print. And so that gives you like just like a quick thing to show you what the difference would be. So the lacquer is actually something after they cut it that can be played back. And so that's what they're emulating. But you can only do so many playbacks because it's softer than the actual, a vinyl disc that you end up with is more durable in the end. But the quality suffers a bit, as you can hear. So you're getting some of that warmth. But now if you take this anyways, and let's just start with the print. And now we switch this and we say, all right, now let's go off the Abbey Road and onto a DJ turntable, which probably is a Technics turntable. I'm guessing that was probably one of the most common DJ turntables. So that would be... Now we have the MM cartridge, a moving magnet. The MC cartridge, it's more of a modern cartridge, a moving coil cartridge, more for hi-fi. See, it's more open sounding. And then there's more of a modern DJ cartridge. I'm guessing this is probably like a reissue Shure M44. So you could hear, like, just with this, there's a lot of tonal variation, and each one has, like, a real character. You know, like, this DJ cartridge has a bit more hyped high-end and low-end, so it sort of stretches the top-bottom aspect of it. So you could hear a lot of tonal generation things that happen. What's even, not only that, this is cool, like, you notice as I move this, my cursor over the needle here, this is also cool because now I can also move the stylus in towards the center, changing the tone and distortion characteristics. There's also an adjustment here on the tone arm. So what you're getting is, sorry for the jumpy screen here. So what you're getting is the most full frequency part of the record, the most high fidelity or high quality part of the record is actually on the outer edge. And as you go towards the middle, because the speed doesn't change, the speed remains the same. Now on this outer side, you know, what would encompass, you know, like, you know, a couple inches of audio, you know, let's say it's a second of audio, you know, is a certain length. When you get to the middle, that shrinks considerably, because if you drew lines, you know, sort of pizza pie lines, into, you know, from the center to the outside, then and you know, you measured that distance, the outside, you know, radius between those two points there versus the inner, you would get that difference. So what happens is the high frequency response suffered, and you also start to bring in more phase distortion. And so this is a thing here, a part of a big reason why a lot of singles on vinyl for DJ release were released on 12-inch vinyl, because they could do like a really deep, like serious high quality cut at 33 1/3 and keep most of the audio towards the outer edge without using a lot of what's going on in the middle. But so you could hear that. Now, nobody really notices that while you're playing the records, because most of the time you're playing from the beginning to the end, and it's a very gradual shift as you go across the whole thing. But if you skipped around from one point to the record, you may have noticed that in the past. I just want to show you one other aspect here of this, which is the distortion here. Anyways, you could use this, and this is probably a little bit too dense, but on other sounds, if you're trying to get some kind of a vintage or a noisy kind of thing on something, you could play around with that a lot. So you have, you know, like high pass, low pass modulator, and then you have, you know, the phase distortion amount right here. So when you default it to zero, it kind of sets it to a nominal area. Likewise, you could take a whole mix here, and you could work with the wow and flutter. Which it can also create kind of cool effects. You know, like that kind of like, just like a weird hyperactive, not hyperactive, but like, you know, kind of rubbery, like melting kind of world type of thing that you could use for certain sounds, especially to capture or take like a string that's maybe a keyboard string type of thing, and then give it some kind of warped flavor that would be hard to do with just kind of modulating a delay. But it's kind of cool. You get a lot of that analog flavor. Same with a flutter. So what you're getting there is variations in gain, and so that's the other. So all of these straight up is giving you what is typical or normal for, you know, a vinyl record. There's also a drive control, which allows you to take and just overdrive the whole thing without affecting any of the other settings. So it's like a control of driving more input while simultaneously lowering the output. So So this is just like a tone generating machine. You could use this for mastering, and probably like on that end, if you're looking for something more hi-fi, working a little bit more, staying with a lacquer. So those are two comparables, the DJ and the MCAR could give you a little bit more hi-fi, the DJ giving you a little bit more edge. But you could see how like that can really shape or pull together a mix. You could use it on a mix bus, you could use it on individual tracks, you can sort of warp, distort, click, crackle, pop, anything like for introductions of songs or anything that you want to just sort of vintage warp out. A lot of stuff to play with here. Very, very cool. And I want to show you one other feature here, which is really fun, which is the slowdown feature. So I'm just going to set it here to just like a couple bars so you could just sort of hear it. But you can extend this up. I can't remember how far this actually extends. Hold on one second. I'm going to zoom out here for a second so I don't keep moving the screen. So this goes up. Well, I don't know. Let's see. If I type in 50, there's a limit here. 15 is the number of bars that it will go. So I'm not sure if that's based on the tempo or not, but that's where I'm at, 120 beats per minute. But that's it in there. But I'm just going to type in a two bar tempo. So what it'll do is it'll slow down over the course of two bars. So there's two ways that I can do this. If I play it, when I hit it, and it will just stop. And then at any point, I want to resume. But if I wanted to use it as an effect and I click in the auto resume, what happens is that as soon as it spins down to the bottom, it immediately picks up again. So I could use it as an effect in like a remix. And then, of course, based on the timing of when I actually click on it, when you automate it in, it'll just kind of line up. And then you get the kind of start that works in time with the song. But otherwise, you could, if you don't want to do it that way, you can also do it with the time base, where you could just use seconds, milliseconds. And that would become your alternative to that. So you can, type it in just as easily that way. To adjust the timing a little bit more accurately. This otherwise just goes, bars, beats. And it's just really cool. It's kind of a fun little feature that you can throw in there and then just throw that in as like an automation thing and just have that be in for a particular sound or on the whole mix bus, which is what I have here for this. And just a lot of tonal control and variation, really crazy plugin, extremely unique, because there's not a whole lot of things that actually, there's nothing else out there that has gone this in depth in emulating something that is a vintage technology and is of course still a part of our lives, and there's also been somewhat of a resurgence of vinyl records recently as well, with a lot of vintage records and newer artists releasing records on vinyl to a kind of growing public. Like there's something about collecting, those records, having an A side and a B side. And this is not like a mastering for actual cutting for vinyl. So don't get that confused. So this is not something that you would then submit to, running it through this plugin and then submit it to a manufacturing plant where they would go and make a master out of it. It's not that kind of idea, but it's meant to bring or engender that type of sound and vibe and allow you to bring that into your current mixing stuff. So really cool plugin, a great one, and nice addition to the Abbey Road collection ever-growing collection from Waves. And that is the plugin of the week, the Abbey Road Vinyl.